Hello, everyone, both here in the room and also online. Welcome. Thank you for being here on such a beautiful day. Thank you for coming indoors with us. My name is Allison Boyd, and I am the Director of Research and Interpretation at the Barnes Foundation. And I'm so pleased to be able to introduce our speaker today. As some of you may know, we're currently in the midst of a huge range of events around the 50th anniversary of Pablo Picasso's death. For anyone who follows us on Instagram, for example, we just started a six-part series about new research that we're doing on Picasso in our collection. And in this context of revisiting Picasso and his legacy and also coming at it from a different direction, I'm so pleased to be able to introduce our speaker today, Joseph Henry. Joseph is the Florence B. Selden Fellow at the Yale University Art Gallery, and he's a PhD candidate at the Graduate Center of the City of University of New York, where he specializes in Euro-American modern art. He has received a huge range of grants and fellowships. I've got the full list, but I'll only name a few. He was the inaugural fellow of the Diamondstein Spielvogel, a fellow at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. He's received DAAD, Mellon, and Whitney Independent Study Program fellowships, teaching fellowships, a whole range of things. He's also done extensive writing on contemporary art across many different publications, such as Art Forum, Art in America, Frieze, Text zur Kunst, and several exhibition catalogs. And his work takes on a broad range of different topics, but it really knits together a range of interests around Euro-American modernism, expressionism, art and labor, drawings and prints, primitivism and colonialism, queer visual culture and historiography. And today we're lucky enough to have him to speak with on the really wonderfully titled Picasso's Melodrama. And we'll have plenty of time afterwards, and I really want to encourage questions and answers, which Joseph has already, you know, really generously agreed to answer your questions afterwards. So, you know, please keep those in mind while he's speaking, and also for those of you online, please feel free to write your questions into the chat. And, you know, I can sort of read them out for you after the talk. With that, thank you again so much for being here, and please join me in welcoming Joseph Henry.
Hi, good afternoon. So are these the folks who went to the marathon or not? I'm interested in the Venn diagram from those who couldn't go to the marathon because they were going to a Picasso lecture and those who couldn't go to the lecture because they were going to the marathon, so forth, and so on. No, but thank you for the really generous, wonderful introduction. It's really fun to be back here at the Barnes giving this paper. There's a couple folks I want to thank. I want to thank Aliyah Palumbo, who did a lot of very last-minute help with this presentation and some last-minute details that came together. Martha Lucy gave me the very kind invitation. I also want to thank Picasso scholar named Francesca Ferrari, who's been the kind of Virgil to my Dante in not the hell that is Picasso studies, but depends who you talk to. I don't know too much to say beyond that. I think I'm going to go right into it. I'll talk for about 45 minute max is the idea, but we should have enough time for a Q&A with that. So without further ado. I hope you will forgive me by beginning my thoughts today with an act of necromancy. I'd like to summon the spirit of the summer of this year back from the dead when the Brooklyn Museum put on the exhibition It's Pablo-matic, Picasso According to Hannah Gadsby. As you may recall, the museum had invited the Australian comedian Hannah Gadsby to curate a selection of Picasso's works alongside their own ribald commentary and with a selection of work by women artists from the museum's holdings. Gadsby was not exactly nonpartisan in their editorialization. Already in their 2017 Netflix special, Nanette, they refused any valorization of Picasso's supposed achievements. There'll be some profanity, bear with me. Quote, "The greatest artist of the 20th century, let's make art great again, guys. Picasso fucked an underage girl, and that's it for me, not interested," end quote. Gatsby here refers to Picasso's romance with Marie-Thérèse Walter, one biographical detail that, for Gatsby, disqualifies any appreciation of Picasso's art. Picasso, for Gatsby, had been given a pass in the name of artistic genius. Let me get the mic a little better. Instead of evaluated along the proper moral and ethical lines. Many of the exhibition texts at the Brooklyn Museum echoed these same sentiments. Gatsby primarily saw Picasso's objects as reflections of his personal love life. Faced with the crying woman, there will be a, somewhat embarrassing, there will be a missing image in one of these slides, so bear with me. There we go. Faced with the crying woman, Gatsby enjoined visitors to, quote, scan from her breasts up to her mid-cheek. Notice anything? That's right, there's a cock and balls, end quote. Likewise, other erogenous zones could be found on the forehead of the supplicant women. We'll see that soon, don't worry, from the same year. Gatsby summarized their findings as such. Despite the artist's heterogeneous output, quote, he really only thoroughly interrogated one subject, his own suffering and the women he blamed for it, end quote. Thus, for any works that exposed a different thematic, Gatsby insisted that, quote, I have no time for all the declaring that Guernica was the greatest anti-war statement of the 20th century, not least because it didn't work. He was not creatively fixated on either war or politics. Well, I would say that he was too busy creating art about his dick and all the women he was jabbing it with to give the shadow of war too much thought, end quote. I will leave it up to you as to whether Gatsby's analyses successfully pried open a new dimension in discussions on the artist, or whether their jokes killed as comedic interventions. I myself wrote a long essay on the exhibition in the magazine Art Forum that I don't need to reiterate here. Suffice it to say, Gatsby's project prompted a mostly negative critical reception, as you might recall. As an artistic analysis, these critics voiced, the exhibition refused to consider any tactic of irony, contradiction, or misdirection in Picasso's practice. Gatsby judged his work to be totally transparent of his personal feelings and predilections. And in terms of art history, the enterprise bludgeoned any of the work's complexities with a flattening insistence on this biography. It was the details of his affairs and romances that took center stage over the art itself. Jason Farrago, there we go. I'll find the right direction. Is it over here? There we go. Okay, maybe it's right here. Okay. Jason Farrago, in his review for the New York Times, noted that, was he say kick it? That was very funny. Noted that such a biographical insistence ignored an already very established genealogy and scholarship that had already thoroughly deconstructed the presence of biography. He mentions the contributions of feminist art history in particular, which argued that any overinvestment in Picasso's love life only suppressed the individualities of the women typecast in the roles of muse, girlfriend, victim. Okay, that's where it goes. Here we have a continuum of what we might call good interpretation and bad biography, at least in the perspective of the art historian, considered in the last, usually the expert on a given artistic moment. Good interpretation is the province of academic art history and elite media, I think we can say. No doubt these scholars have learned biographical information, but puts that information towards the service of the artist's aesthetic accomplishments, theoretical nuances, social contributions, and political arguments. For Picasso, good interpretation catalyzed some of the most consequential art history in this country, at least since the 1980s onwards. Perhaps these days one would be pressed to find a younger scholar, however, working on him. Bad biography, alternatively, thrives among mass market venues, from TV and movie adaptations to nonfiction, sometimes literary bestsellers. For Picasso, this seems especially to be the case. We could have chided Hannah Gatsby and the Brooklyn Museum for not properly reading up on their sophisticated art history, but they also might be forgiven were we to consume recent materials on the artist. In the somewhat recent miniseries Genius, for example, on the National Geographic Channel, the narrative joins itself fully to the women who both decorate and dictate the artist's life: Olga Kolklova, Marie-Thérèse Walter, Dora Maar, François Gillot, and Jacqueline Roche. In venues such as these, bad biography addresses different kinds of audiences, though. It does matter, I think, that for many non-critics who took in Pablomatic, there was something refreshing, even valuable, in learning of the artist's actions and attitude towards his partners. Indeed, biography for many provides something like the emotional truth of the artist and of art itself. If we are attached to the idea that art is an expression of something internal to one's person, then biography shows the routes such expression can take. This is a bit benign, but I think it'll kind of activate at the end of this talk. There's no reason, of course, we need to cling to this continuum as a polarity. My sketch is a schematic rendering at best. But what I want to do today is at least to try out a switch from biography as genre to biography as medium. That is, biography as some kind of substance that can be shaped and stretched, whether in art historical scholarship, curatorial practice, or art making. And for sure, we should make a distinction between biography, which is, let's say, a textual account, and the actual life of an artist, which would be kind of unrecoverable in the last. In its varying degrees, biography is something that can be exercised to modulate the audiences we want to address, the politics we wish to advance, and the aesthetic values we aim to foreground. By we, I'm imagining us, curators, scholars, educators, but as artgoers, we also get to decide what we want of the artwork, whether just itself on its own terms or the story that calls it into being. Surely, though, the papers are sliding, these sentiments can apply to any artist, whether Matisse, Renoir, Seurat, or Soutine, to name a few relevant figures today. But Picasso heightens the question of biography, not just for the personal actions of his life, eyebrow-raising as they may be, but for the nature of his art, particularly that of the cubist idiom and the reiterations thereafter. And for that, we will need to follow the path of good interpretation. In 1980, the art historian Rosalind Krauss launched what is probably the most influential critique of biographical methodology in her essay, In the Name of Picasso, published in the journal October. Krauss was responding to a particular apex of Picasso's legacy, an enormous exhibition at the Museum of Modern Art in New York, around which the magazine Art in America had dedicated an entire issue. Krauss took fault that in this recent flurry of critical and scholarly attention, the meaning of each of Picasso's works was dictated by, in so many words, the source material of each painting. Instead of thinking about how forms worked, how description itself functioned, how meaning was made, commentators attached every image to some kind of biographical quotient. In the painting La Vie of 1904, for example, Krauss noted that for much of the painting's reception, it was positioned through, as you can see, the structuring of multiple planes and representation in the general context of a fin de siècle allegory of painting. La Vie, in other words, in being painting on canvas that showed paintings on canvas, was about painting as such. But in 1967, the male figure on the left was identified as Picasso's friend Casamigas, who had committed suicide in 1902, and whose quote, these are Krauss's words, lurid details of impotence marked his presence in the Picasso literature. From that point on, La Vie was a, quote, tableau vivant containing the dead man torn between two women, the meaning of which is, Krauss is being ironic, sexual dread. That interpretation may not be wrong, Krauss acknowledged, but it left the painting's, quote, ultimate aesthetic relevance yet to be proved or even given art historical fashion argued, end quote. Once applied to Picasso's cubist work, this virulent and obvious approach in Picasso's studies became even more ironic. Krauss solidified in this essay what in Anglo-American art history became known as the semiotic analysis of cubism. This means an interpretation based on the qualities of graphic and linguistic signs. I'm going to try and condense what can sometimes be a torturous series of texts into something I think we can work with together. This was already a venerable framework. Picasso's dealer and author of the first substantial treatments of cubism, Daniel Henry Kahnweiler, wrote in his 1920 text, The Rise of Cubism, that the painting of Picasso and Georges Braque no longer had to imitate the appearance of visual reality, but instead we could write with signs or stimuli for objects or their qualities. In glass and packet of cigarettes here at the Barnes, for example, the titular objects seem to have been deconstructed into not just their constituent parts, but the constituent parts of their visual appearance. The glass is broken down into the forms that make its tectonic structure, so its actual shape, but so too are the shadows it casts and the light it gathers shattered as well. So it's not that the vase is being shattered into different parts, it's that how it looks is being shattered into different parts. Like that part of the shadow can go there, that part of the highlighting can go there in a cubist painting. Because we already know what a glass looks like in the real world, Kahnweiler philosophized, we can then put the object back together in our mind, not unlike the reconfiguration of a sentence with words that have been put out of order. Kahnweiler was not issuing a polemic against biographical readings, not in 1920, but in positing cubism as language, he was on one hand mitigating what we could call the expressive function of the artist. So this is the kind of artist I think we're usually affiliated with, the idea that when I make art, I express something about myself to somebody. This is the kind of basic way of art making that's being challenged here. So if I have to communicate with others, I am indeed bound to a language that is defined by its commonality to all speakers. I cannot make myself explicable if I were to fabricate entirely new words, for example, which is to say, if language mediates articulation, it would automatically hinder any primal conveyance of my feelings and desire. We're getting away from this theoretical section, I promise. But the idea is that if we're speaking in a language that I can't actually express, I have to use a language that is artificial to me to some extent. Other commentators continued this general linguistic theorization, especially as it pertained to later collage works. In a piece like Composition with Violin, this part's more fun, I promise, we see on the instrument's right-hand side that the newsprint is almost equated with the drawn shadow that is supposedly thrown by the violin. So let's try this. So this, for example, that piece of newspaper could also be the shadow that is falling off the violin just as much as that drawn shadow could also be that shadow. The newspaper, yes, we see on the instrument's right-hand side the newspaper is almost equated with the drawn shadow that is supposedly thrown by the violin. These are two ways of signifying the same thing. Shadow, or two words, if you will, for the same concept. So newspaper, drawn thing are both adding up to shadow. But for Krauss, this reading could be pushed further. Newspaper on the right-hand side may represent shadow, right? It doesn't look like one, but it's standing in for shadow. But it also notated the extension of the swelling of the violin's lower bass. So we could also look at it as being this is actually the edge of the violin itself, right? And we could put that together in our mind. In this case, it is not the shadow that can be described by the same word, but one word, the newspaper, can mean two different things. So that same element can mean shadow or it can mean part of the violin. Moreover, if the newspaper can be both the surface of the central object and the shadow, Picasso enacts this through what is literally a flat piece of paper attached to another piece of paper, the newspaper pasted on the support. We have an actual thing, that piece of newspaper, that is communicating the opposite of its factual basis, as if I said the phrase, I love you, and one could tell it was a statement of utter hatred. So in this case, it's supposed to be funny, that one. What I mean is that, so the newspaper is, of course, we can't see on this reproduction on this slide, but that's a physical thing that is adding physical weight to that paper, but here is made to look completely flat. It's being opposite of what it's supposed to be. Additionally, we can think of how one would describe the kinds of material were this an illusionistic depiction, a more illusionistic depiction. So if I wanted to show the grain of the wood and the penumbra of the shadow, if I wanted to draw those in a much more realistic kind of drawing. Instead of drawing in these facets directly, Picasso has the newspaper act as both. So the words printed on that newspaper now have to make sense in an entirely different language. So the words that we could read, in this case probably French language, now have to become tone or kind of atmosphere, despite what they might signify as language. Instead of drawing in these facets directly, yeah, exactly. Collage makes these at times dizzying reversals. It's quite complicated, most explicit. But for Krauss, even later cubism could still perform, quote, the insistence of figure ground reversal and the continual transposition between negative and positive form. This was a formal resource that, quote, derives from collage's command of the structure of signification. There is thus, for most of Picasso's oeuvre, no stable speech, I want to say. Cubism is all about, we could say, the concretization of communication as a process. And to short-circuit that process by finding this or that reference to an actual occasion, for Krauss, this happened. This was a dance on the, quote, grave of form. Krauss and the semiotic model that followed is now near grad school catechism. It has been turned critiqued, problematized, complicated, but it'll be sufficient for us if we take away for today that Picasso's art in nearly all of its guises refuses an absolute connection between the pictorial operations of his art and a stable biographical detail. Surely most artists obey this tact. It is rare when an artist absolutely insists on an autobiographical connection. But as Krauss indicated, that facet of Picasso's work was all the important for others, for critics and their ilk, to check their own biographical impulse. If Krauss did not dictate the politics of her position beyond an intellectual correction, similar points would be made indeed by feminist art historians themselves. In an earlier and canonical work called Why Have There Been No Great Women Artists, the art historian Linda Nochlin cast doubt on, I'm gonna read this quote, it's a good one, naive idea that art is the direct personal expression of individual emotional experience, a translation of personal life into visual terms. The making of art involves a self-consistent language of form, more or less dependent upon or free form given temporally defined conventions, schemata, or systems of notation, which have to be learned or worked out, either through teaching, apprenticeship, or a long period of individual experimentation. The language of art is more materially embodied in paint and line on canvas or paper, in stone or clay or plastic or metal. It is neither a sob story nor a confidential whisper. It's an amazing sentence. Sob story. Nochlin's phrasing is wryly hyperbolic, but it also asks, what would a sob story of art look like? Could there be a sob story cubist painting, for example, given the conditions I just discussed? To pivot back to the maybe, at this point, logically battered arena of Pablomatic, when at the Brooklyn Museum, when I was there, I could not shake what seemed to be the biographical instance beyond all others, a painting titled The Shadow from 1953. Here is how the exhibition's wall label put it. Quote, you can read it with me, made just after François Gillot left Picasso, the only one of his partners who did, this painting is among his most nuanced self-portraits. His shadow looms over an image of Gillot reclining nude in their home in the south of France, surrounded by the homey touches of a vase and a toy horse in a chariot. Picasso's vantage point, which the viewer shares, is given form by the dark silhouette. The shadow places him both inside and outside the composition, and the image of Gillot reads simultaneously as a painting, a memory, and a vision. That's their wall label, which is a good wall label. I'm not trying to point fault at it. This, though, was a very different Picasso than the predatory Don Juan Gadsby figured in their commentary. This was a sad Picasso, an abandoned Picasso, and also an old Picasso painting that work as he was in his 70s. What I seem to have encountered was this, a quasi-cubist impersonality pushed to the absolute limits of confessionalism. Indeed, sadness can be presented many different ways, but in the terms in the shadow, it's so pronounced, almost cinematic. Picasso, or his shadow, looms over Gillot per the Brooklyn label, but it's not a looming of, say, leering authority, but almost reticence. The small sway with which Picasso was oriented the shade implies not so much a violent approach, but a distancing withdrawal. This sense of transit is only magnified by the aperture Picasso installs in the foreground, that door, theoretically, which casts the odalisque's figure in marble white and then leads the extremities to fade into gray. And what about it? What of the abandoned children's toy at the very top, an almost too maudlin motif of parental separation? The shadow in the immediate year of 1953 will motivate the rest of my lecture today. It and other paintings from the same week, let alone year, so these are all in the same week, it's actually a 3-day span, limb the edge between bad biography and good interpretation. As we will see, they dramatize nothing less than the dissolution of a nearly decade-long partnership between Picasso and Gillot, a dissolution that has become a key episode in various Picasso narratives, and we'll see a lot of them. That episode itself is, in so many words, a sob story. Yet Picasso's paintings employ a late cubist language of faceted planes, segmented ground, and importantly, a semiotic displacement of the agentive subject. By that, I mean it centers a shadow version of the protagonist, a walking reversal of figure ground that Krauss had mentioned this was a lesson learned from collage. With these paintings, I want to track this intersection of Picasso's work in the cubist project, but also I want to hazard an absolute overreading of these paintings. Not so much of Picasso's life per se, but of the melodramatic aspect these works present. Most commentators on Picasso are more than proficient at detailing the feints and inversions of his representational language, but few within art history are willing to entertain what happens when Picasso insists on his own biography and emotional life. Quote, there is a false assumption in much art writing that we can be smart about emotions only if we are being cynical about them, end quote, the performance scholar Jennifer Doyle has written. I'm not trying to insist on my or your sincerity, but rather I'm aiming to think about what happens even when within cubism we are faced with this kind of sentimentalism. As John Richardson, Picasso's foremost biographer, put it, quote, Françoise thinks these paintings are unique, the only time Picasso ever gave way to nostalgia, end quote. And venturing to 1953, we are entering the territory of Picasso's late work. Did that go through? There we go. Picasso's late work, a territory more often than not discounted in stylistic evaluations of the artist's career. Quote, little in what Picasso has done since 1938 tells the professionally concerned eye anything it does not already know from his previous work, the taste-making critic Clement Greenberg flatly stated in 1957. That dismissal aside, it seems as if by the 50s, Picasso had settled on an arsenal of cubist morphologies articulated since the teens. I'll be a little fast with this part. These morphologies were less the individual sickle, hinge, or cylinder that some scholars have seen in the analytical moment, but instead broader networks of linear constellations Picasso had developed with the Apollinaire project and then made more programmatic in 1948's The Kitchen. Concurrently, Picasso increasingly relied in the 50s on a constructive planar layers. Let's skip ahead. Constructive planar layers at scene at places in these two works. So his kind of basic vocabulary in the 50s does not these kind of swirling curlicue forms in the teens, but these kind of layers of quite clean, actually consistent planar forms like you're seeing here. We assume these are made to be depictions of Gillot. And so it's actually in the parodies. Well, I won't show them today, but there are these parodies, we could call them, of Delacroix and Velazquez that blow up this language, though I do want to acknowledge. And there is the Guernica moment as well, going back. So this is the supplicant moment that we didn't have on the first time. Sorry about that. There it is. This Guernica moment, meanwhile, had taught Picasso an almost expressionist gestural figuration that he would continue in certain portraits and genre scenes. That is all, to be sure, in terms of painting. His drawing, for example, here, would reach the desultory self-effacement of the human comedy suite, is what this is called, that bookended the shadow paintings, while the sculpture veered between the poles of the ready-made works and the artisanal ceramic output he was known for in the 50s. The suite of late 53 works combined the planar and the figurative impulse in Picasso's painting and seemed to elaborate this vocabulary. Both the shadow... So this is actually... This is the wrong orientation, so in a moment of radical imagination, assume this is at a horizontal going that way, if you can do that. So it should be to the left. Maybe at the end we can put it right ways up. I think you might have seen it actually in those three together. Was it the right way like that? Okay. Both Shadow on Woman and the Shadow date from the exact same day. In the former, Picasso deposits a reclining nude on a sofa as a shadow swaying in a doorway cast over her body. This was not a period of great articulation of the nude. Picasso was working through it, though, although it seems Picasso explored at the same time a grisaille kind of figure. In Shadow on Woman, Picasso apportions the silhouette's effects like different lenses in a camera or gels in a light source. The penumbra turns the model's otherwise alabaster flesh into a meaty red. It finds a gray rectangle, again, you'll have to revert your vision a little bit, very cubist, actually. It finds a gray rectangle in the frame up above and renders the sky blue couch into something deeper, more aquatic. Notice here already the planar device I had mentioned. It's literalized into a series of outlines. The light from the doorway shifts to the right, the frame atop dodges it to the left, and the fireplace or the ledge stabilizes it by standing erect. A certain cinematic lighting effect is unavoidable to my eyes. This is the body flooded with lights and narratively speaking the female awaking perhaps to find the shadow standing above her. So it's still the wrong direction, so imagine it looks like this. The shadow made the same day, and this was actually the right direction, thank God, softens the mood of Shadow on Woman even as it complicates this compositional structure. Picasso had reoriented all the edges. The door opening cuts to the left, the fireplace gets pushed onto the far right side, and more architectural vectors make themselves known. It is almost a pivot on the same scene to reveal more effects in this domestic environment. We see more corners in the room, and we see the aforementioned toy chariot up above. Earlier, I had mentioned that this didn't seem like a picture of aggression or dominance. I think that comes down to how Picasso figures the shadow. The shadow doesn't have the creaturely sloping body of Shadow on Woman. Instead, the artist provides an explicit posture with shoulders that humanizes figure to some extent. We also lose the film noir optics of matte black and searing white from Shadow on Woman. Picasso divides the shadow into cooler browns. By the time we get to Female Nude in the Studio from December, that's in the right direction. By December 30th of that year, Picasso had abandoned his shadow for a far more elaborated view of this interior. This is an amazing work. This is actually quite hard to find. It's very rarely reproduced, and so it's fun to talk about. The painting itself is a moderately sized 35 by 46 inches, yet it feels huge. A lattice network of easels, canvases, and compartments climb upwards on the left into a skyline of a studio. So I should say here, the literature, the commonplace is that we're looking at a bedroom in Picasso's house. It also seems to be studio space at the same time. Picasso himself will call it a bedroom. The nude now resides in a different section of this room, flanked and surrounded by windows and strong corners left dim by the dark lighting scheme. The pocked, brushy area at the bottom of the shadow, so that middle painting, now turns into the richly ornamented carpets that follow the room's general slant downwards. And of course, the toy chariot now perches on the left-hand side, or the right-hand side, actually. In his study of interwar cubism, the art historian T.J. Clark argues that the movement was fundamentally concerned with the ambiguous role of the 19th century bourgeois interior. Clark calls this room space, quote, a space that is absolute in its proximity to us, but at the same time, this is the true strangeness, fundamentally unbounded and untouchable, end quote. Rarely, I think, has room space felt so unbounded in Picasso as it does in Female Nude in the Studio. It is a world that spills out, almost engulfing the nude in the middle. In those shadow paintings, we can observe the drama of the looming or abating silhouette, but something about this later picture is more nefarious, more willing to say out loud that the woman belongs to the artist's practice like any other effect in his atelier. And atelier pictures are what these now seem to be. With the abundance of easels gathered in female nude in the studio, Picasso demands we look again at the framing devices of the week's paintings overall. So back to the other ones over here. Again, I'm in the wrong direction. We assume in the earlier works that we are looking through the enframing of a door with light streaming in, but do these illuminated areas actually signify a canvas, with its edges determining what enters the frame? Are the shadowy humanoids substitutes for the artist, as we have imagined, or are they actually characters within the world of the picture, within the actual painting? If all of these images are meant to depict a real studio, namely Picasso's or bedroom, does this artist imply this woman is a model posing for that picture, or is she already a pictorial entity already inscribed onto the canvas? Has Krauss mentioned in the name of Picasso, in the name of Picasso, scenarios set in studios or in studio-like spaces function as allegories of representation itself? These 1953 works question precisely the reality or the truthfulness of what is supposed to be Picasso's space. The studio, at least, would be an overriding preoccupation of Picasso's late work, especially throughout the 1960s and in those drawings that bookended the 1953 paintings. In these works, Picasso explicitly staged painting or drawing in media res, where we see the act of representation in action. Often he cast the artist in various guises he had explored throughout his career, from the bohemian painter with the outdoorsy hat that we saw earlier, to the more senescent figures gamely trying to keep their work alive. This was a shift from Picasso's important studio pictures, mainly of the late 1920s, where while Picasso signaled himself with silhouettes and iconography of easel or palette, the paintings seem more like holding stations of figures brought to various states of extremity. Painter and Model from 1928. In this painting, he pushed hard on abstraction, splitting the scene into a frieze of vectors and angles. In The Artist and His Model from the year prior, the studio becomes a sort of primal scene for the distortion of the figure, where that distortion feels like a morphological pull against the rigidity of the architecture around it. The 1953 paintings, however, reverse the standard orientation. Go back a little bit. The one on the left, right? This reverses the orientation of the studio scenes. Here, the viewer is interpolated as either the painting artist or the beholder of the canvas within that painting's reality. The woman's body, or the image of us, is available to us more optically than haptically. Notice, however, that what often accompanies almost all of these studio scenes is the presence of a shadow. In the MoMA painting, Picasso inserts his silhouette, if you can see it over here, Picasso inserts his silhouette in the middle above the palette. The same outline appears in other paintings of the 20s, such as Bust of a Woman with Self-Portrait. You can see the nose, it's a bit hard to see, from 1929. It already cast its form, too, in the Harlequin of 1915. Shadow, less iconic here, right, it's kind of hiding as these silhouettes, also plays the roles of naturalistic ground when enlisted in the portrait of Olga. So not his face, but shadow has to stand in for the very possibility of a realistic scene here. Even in very different media contexts, the shadow accompanies the act of painting. In the very beginning of the 1956 documentary by Henri-Georges Clouzot, The Mystery of Picasso, this is the very first scene, our protagonist moves to the easel, casting a shadow through the film's moody studio lighting. But why should shadows accompany these scenes of artistic production? Surely studio paintings or films should be about the absolute presence of the creator in the midst of making, of the conviction of bringing representation to light and maybe to life through artistic will. Instead, shadows in these mise-en-scène imply different orders of formalization, from the painted lines that will make up the image to the shadow, to the shadow inherently cast often by the artist himself. So basically, all these paintings involving shadows are saying who is creating the various kinds of form here, right? The body itself is kind of by default creating form, but the artist is more artificially, perhaps, creating form himself. So form is being produced by a number of different channels. Yet, in the artificial context of art, shadows are just as deliberate. Shadows activate economies of illusionism. They render the artist as a producer of all kinds of images, from his literal body to his aesthetic production. To the body, the artist becomes a sort of medium. In this regard, shadows often imply a doppelganger effect. I'll move ahead a little bit. A doppelganger effect. This was the literary understanding of the shadow as a sort of evil double that acted independent of its creator and in its independence sapped an originary wholeness, as a romantic tradition of the shadow. Shadows qualify hierarchies of reality. In fact, shadows pertain, to an oft-theorized origin of two-dimensional depiction in the Western tradition to the myth of the so-called Corinthian maid, often referred to as Diputades or the Chora of Sicyon. I'm not going to pronounce that Greek correctly. It is natural history. Pliny attaches this story to the invention of sculptural clay modeling, but he still speaks of Butades, a potter of Sicyon at Corinth. He did this owing to his daughter, who was in love with a young man, and she, when he was going abroad, drew an outline on the wall, the shadow of his face thrown by a lamp. Her father pressed clay on this and made a relief. So the origin of art making in this one account comes from this woman who's going to mourn a man who's soon leaving, and it's her father who turns that into a sculpture. The shadow thus accompanies the earliest conceptualizations of artistic practice. In Western culture, then, art is the long consequence of a love story. But these paradoxes seem worth teasing out. Whereas Debutades could have recorded the direct likeness of her paramour, like why do the shadow, why not do a picture of his face, or acquired a corporeal trace of his person, such as a fingerprint, she sketches out his shadow. As a memento, the shadow is only possible by the literal existence of the beloved, but it is also entirely precarious as a reproduction. Shadows can be simulated and altered, and they tend to distort the appearance of their origin more than they capture real truth, right? A shadow is usually a distortion of how you actually look. It's actually not the best kind of record of what you look like. In the Corinthian myth, then, it is less perhaps that the maid aims to preserve what will ultimately be gone. She instead marks her companion as already in the process of being lost. He is becoming a memory in real time. Representation in this lofty narrative, this kind of ancient one, is not about restoring the absent object as it is departing from it. Picasso, here we go. This is one example where you could always see shadows in kind of studio scenes. Like this is an 18th century example, for example. Here we go. Picasso, although not as avidly committed to mythology in 1953, along these lines seems to summon the shadow less as a malefic twin than as an attenuated self. Between the model, that may or may not be an image, the shadow, that may or may not be an image, and the composition, which may be a painting already, the withdrawal from love is about the constant remediation of the self, about trying to ground oneself in a destabilized reality as the lover leaves. It is with this in mind that we might strike at the core of the reference that Picasso installs in the paintings in 1953. That is, let's consider them as breakup paintings. To do so would be a flagrant violation of these paintings' complexities, maybe, but I think we can take seriously when Picasso wants to be diaristic, even through things like the toy, the specific date he gives us, the day, December 23rd, or 25th, or 29th, in his own words, is what he says to the photojournalist David Douglas Duncan, quote, "That was our bedroom. Do you see my shadow? I had just come away from the window. So now do you see my shadow in the light of the sun falling on the bed and the floor?" End quote. To contextualize what led to the separation, I will give the sketchiest of narratives for the sake of time. This is the love story, so to speak. That's also upside down, as you can probably guess. Picasso met the painter François Gillot, as numerous biographies would have it, in 1943 at his usual haunt in Paris, the Café Le Catalan. An initial relationship based on each other's work turns into a romance, one that is duly informed by the privileged itineraries of the French elite and the specters of Picasso's former relationships. There's a séjour in Gauche-Chouin, there's Gillot's initial refusal to move in with him, there's a miserable period in a house in Ménage, where Dora Maar, that's where she's supposed to be living, there's harassment by Picasso's ex-wife Olga, there's a friend's generous offer to stay at the Chateau Grimaldi, and moving through this life quickly, and Picasso's new enthusiasm for the Communist Party, actually. In 1947, their son Claude was born. In 1948, Picasso bought his Campagne La Galaise in the town of Valoris. In 1949, their daughter Paloma was born. That dissolved the painful period of 1953, which concerns us today. As Gillot relays in her 1964 memoir, Life with Picasso, the relationship had become increasingly prohibitive. We hear of Picasso's expectations that Gillot forego her art practice to act as a caretaker for him, for the house, for the children. We hear of affairs conducted patently in public, his affairs. We hear of more difficult episodes, as when Picasso branded Gillot with a cigarette as a gesture of proprietorship, and I'll read this quote. "He took the cigarette he was smoking and touched it to my right cheek and held it there. He must have expected me to pull away, but I was determined not to give him the satisfaction. After what seemed like a long time, he took it away. 'No,' he said, 'that's not a very good idea. After all, I may still want to look at you.'" End quote. When Gillot gathers the willpower to depart from Picasso, she writes that, "I knew I had to leave him because I'd finally come to realize that I didn't have the strength to go on. On the other hand, I had a terrible sense of desperation and not being able to go on. I loved him, and I felt that for the children's sake, it would be certainly be better if we stayed together." And then we have this kind of brutal painting she makes called Freedom, where Claude is writing Liberté on this chalkboard, and she's kind of stuck at home doing childcare over here. After prolonged deliberation and an invigorating gig designing sets and costumes for the choreographer in Paris, Jeanine Charras, Gillot leaves. It is an episode dramatized numerous times across the Picasso and Gillot literature. I offer here a recent depiction from the aforementioned Genius TV show, in part because it condenses some of the events, and in part because I want to contend with what is the melodrama of this scenario. This is always the golden moment. Sorry? Is it too fast? Okay. Understood. Thank you. So we will now watch this TV show that's going on here. Okay, this should work. It's about a minute, 2 minutes.
You have come to your senses.
Yes, I have.
I knew you would. No one understands you like I do.
Pablo, I'm leaving you.
Don't tell me. Now you want to do an opera.
I'm not joking. I can't live with you anymore.
Is there someone else?
Costas.
My nephew's friend? Is that who you chose to replace me? He's an amateur philosopher?
The last thing I need is a replacement. I need to be free to work and live the way I want. I need to learn how to be happy. I have made some arrangements for the children to start school in September in Paris. We'll be leaving then.
But we both know that you will never do that. Without me, what would your life be?
I don't know. But it will be my own.
Well, then you will be known as the foolish woman who left Picasso.
That's a nice summary of that kind of break. Most of that language is taken from her autobiography. Move on. We have a very different scene. I'm not going to play this entire thing for the sake of time, but this is from a movie called Surviving Picasso from 1996. We'll get a sense of how it's different from like the first minute on.
This much for you? You have no existence apart from me. Without me, you're nothing. People will see you as nothing. They'll forget you.
It's enough of that, I think. So very different approaches. And again, Gillot's account, a lot of that dialogue from the first scene comes from that. And everyone has a different take on this. It actually gets divided by gender. So female biographers will often replicate her language. Male biographers tend to either totally discount her, or there's a very venerable account by someone named Roland Penrose, and he says, that basically it's too indecent to even discuss what happens, is what his approach is. And so the 1953 paintings record the aftermath of what just happened. Following a holiday alone in December, Picasso makes these three paintings. Even worse than breakup paintings, these are Christmas paintings. We thus have a totally overdetermined biographical event, itself already an aesthetic moment in the various media through which it is rendered at all levels of cultural hierarchy, from the TV series to the kind of nice book. Picasso, I don't think, shies away from this confessional aspect of this painting, even in the melodramatic. As I mentioned, if I wonder if this comes down to more than anything the toys that circulate between two of the works, what Richardson identifies as the Sicilian toys for Claude and Paloma. They are not incidental motifs, it's also reverse. Picasso fabricated his own toys for them and even dedicated quite sophisticated paintings to these toys. I just want to make, I'll condense my time a little bit, that they work as what's called a motivated sign in Cubism. Usually the question of Cubism is, do they make any sense in how they appear in graphic form? But in this kind of Cubist painting, the toy is absolutely motivated by this biographical connection. So I'll move forward a little bit for the sake of time. I have been skirting around the term melodrama, and that rosebud-like chariot might cue us into a filmic imaginary for sure. I do not necessarily mean that Picasso drew inspiration from a melodramatic, theatrical, or cinematic tradition, but rather that the heightened affect of the 53 pictures might not just ask us to work with biography more, it also might motivate the formal structures of these paintings. In an influential essay on Hollywood melodrama, the late film critic Thomas Elsasser consolidated what he saw as the qualities in work by directors like Douglas Sirk and Vincent Minnelli. Elsasser's terms correspond directly to what Picasso seems after. Elsasser writes of a, quote, plasticity in the modulation of optical planes and spatial masses, a Cubist phrase if there ever was one. More narratively, Elsasser observes that the dramatic configuration, the pattern of the plot, makes the characters, regardless of attempts to break free, they constantly look inwards at each other and themselves. The characters are, so to speak, each other's sole referent. There is no world outside to be acted on, no reality that could be defined or assumed unambiguously. The best melodramas, Elsasser continues, manage to present all the characters convincingly as victims, and this is a kind of crucial point, I think, well suited for the December 30th painting. What makes for melodrama is not just gesturality, not just a kind of shouting or screaming, as you might expect, not the heightened expression of self-insistent, but instead the ambient structure of the world itself. And so I think I'm going to move forward a little bit more. And as we tend to the biographical surplus, I'll move through these just a little bit faster. You can start seeing these various things that make the melodrama of this period. So we can start looking for shadows in all of these photographs. This is an earlier one by Robert Capa, like the war photographer, when he's on assignment there. Notice also, too, when the shadow is coming off from this sculpture that is often seen as representing Gillot, who's pregnant. And then here, in this really kind of almost too much to bear, this is that L'année Terrible, this 1953, we have the whole family in this kind of shadow version of them, this drawing that Picasso does in profile and silhouette. There we go. And then from that series of drawings that he's doing from late 53 to early 54, this is in a kind of amazing version of that, where we have the artist who's, who's masked himself. So it's like a clown or kind of performer figure who's acting as the artist, and the artist has been banished, has a shadow to that canvas. And this kind of brutal depiction of artistic modeling, right, where you want a kind of affectively neutral model who's not going to be hyper-emotional, and to do that, she has to wear a mask. So if there's any depiction of a kind of artistic marriage that's falling apart, this, I think, stands among them. So I'll move that. These works from across the early 1950s tell us something about artistic production in relation to a melodramatic scene of cleaved romance. They tell us of the artist's internal displacement and of the possibility of a Cubist style that both disavows reference while allowing moments of an affective punch. Cubism, despite the semiotic reading we heard from earlier, was not just a linguistic deferral of essence all the way down to total mediation. And I'm going to move forward here too a little bit. And so Rosalind Krauss, I'll summarize this, has a very beautiful passage that we can read later, and where she talks about in 1910, you have these kind of attempts at depth that never quite match. So in this painting from 1910, it's the breast for her that is both totally flat, kind of available, but ultimately gone. So we have a different pictorial unit for 1953. But recall that it was the planar buildup that determines movement here. That is, this is the possibility of touch foregone, right? It's not even the breast that's aware, it's these layers that push us back and back and back. These are all paintings about an encounter after the fact. If this is the artist's shadow, it is thrown not even from the doorway, but from behind the doorway, toward a model who is, if not sleeping, then will not move. So everyone here is actually a stand-in for the actual romantic partner. The act of breaking up is, in this case, a fait accompli. I'll finish up here. This reading I just gave is now a projection, but one that I think this corpus invites more than others, but it also refuses it. It is thus a projection onto Picasso, too, and whatever we think of someone lost even to himself in Christmas 1953. Here's what Hélène Prémolin wrote in the preface to her memoir on the Spaniard, quote, "For one knows him so little when one begins to know him, and later one not knows him at all, but at least one is aware of it." And I'll end my thoughts for today. Thank you, folks, for listening. And thanks to the folks online, too.
Thank you so much, Joseph, for this really kind of rich, against the grain reading. With that, I think I will please anyone who is online, please put your questions in the chat. But I'll open it up first, and I can read them out loud for you, but I'll also open it up to the audience for any questions for Joseph. I see one right here. I can pass it along to you.
Thank you, wonderful talk. I wanted to ask you, what is the best biography of Picasso? And Joe Rischel told me it was Jalou when I asked him.
Yeah.
And my second quick question is, could the shadows that Picasso is referring to, is he thinking about Plato at all? Mm. Is Plato coming in there too? Because I'm sort of getting a message there. Thank you.
Jalou is worth reading, not because it shows what a kind of women artist is trying to do in the situations he finds herself in the 40s and 50s. It's also extremely insightful about his own practice. So it's the rare thing where we have a kind of nice detail of someone's life, but also insight into their practice. I think everyone would say John Richardson is the kind of standard bearer. It's these huge books. There's like four volumes, but they stop, I think, at 40. They don't go into the 50s from what I recall, but maybe that's not correct. Because he died, also that. And also, I think he was not well banned of his life, too. So there you go. Plato, absolutely, right? And again, I don't know if Picasso is a great reader of philosophy, but even if he's not, we have this notion of the shadow that's not the actual thing, right? This Platonic idea of the cave of shadows. But he is, at one point, he has these phases of great attachment to mythology and kind of Greek culture, so I don't think it's incidental at all. Yeah, good question. Yeah. Oh, sorry, I shouldn't pick on people. It's not what I'm doing.
Oh no. It's very interesting. They almost have like a film storyboard quality to them that I never noticed before. It's you almost feel like the director's, who's probably Picasso, is trying to guide you into the story. I thank you so much for bringing this to us.
Yeah, and I think, there's some research on early cubism where Picasso's going to the movie all the time in the teens and 1890s, but I don't know if he's a moviegoer in these kind of compounds in 50s in Paris. Like, is he going to see, like, Godard, or is he going to see, I don't know what his, like, filmic habits would be in the 1950s. And believe me, I tried very hard to see if he was watching Douglas Sirk, would have made this whole thing quite perfect. Not yet. Thank you, though.
Other questions?
All right, there's a gentleman in the front here.
Yeah.
I think the relevant philosophical reference here is not Plato, but Bergson. Mm. And if you look at this picture in the center, as my wife points out, the background is both, it's not exactly a doorway, it's also a canvas. There's an ambiguity about the canvas on top of another canvas and in a space where there's a layered simultaneity, which is coming right out of Bergson's Creative Evolution. And we know that Matisse actually sat in his lectures at the Sorbonne, and everybody knew about them. There's no doubt that Picasso knew about about Bergson's theories, and I think they really informed his idea of cubism right from the beginning. This is where Krauss and Greenberg take the discourse away from my sense of what the reality of cubism was about. It's a red herring, as far as I can see. And I think you're arguing much, much more cogently about this than she did. So I applaud you for that. I think we need to look at Bergson here and look at what this idea of this complex simultaneity and change over time in that picture is going on. You know, it's like a sequence of observations over time.
Yeah. Yeah, I completely agree, and I think there'd be more to say about the temporality of these pictures, because there's something, the image that I can't quite drop is the figure that enters the doorway. This is such a specific narrative moment. Like, again, I think of the cinematic devices. And so that, to me, would push against the simultaneity of this, again, this trope, it's a cliche of the shadow who enters the doorframe. I think you're totally correct, and I would want to talk more about what is the temporality of the possibility of reproduction, right? If these are all canvases that can be activated into modalities of representation, then how does the time temporality of that figure? But that's a post-talk conversation. Thank you, though.
Yes, other questions? And I should also say, you will all see me on my phone. I promise I am not texting. I am watching for your questions in the chat, so please do feel free to put ones in here.
Thank you so much for this wonderful talk. I have two questions, I hope. It's not too many, but one question is, I know you mentioned melodrama, especially in cinematic terms, but Picasso was someone who was very much thinking about performative environments. He's someone who's been painting circus performers, for example, since the beginning of his careers. He's someone who has created stage designs and costume designs for the Badajoz in the south of France in the 19-teens and 1920s, keeping into account strong spotlights, for example. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as an artist who constantly looks back at his own artistic production, including that and that of other artists, I wonder if there's an element of that, that can be a part of your analysis. And then kind of along the same lines, I was thinking, you know, your beautiful analysis of the shadow as an emblem of both presence and absence makes me think of the trope of the Tom Loy nail in cubism, right? And which kind of looks quite similar to the shadow here. Like, and I wonder if you have some thoughts about, you know, how the shadow of the body can like kind of connect to the shadow of the nail in his early works. And that of the other cubists, of course, like Juan Gris was also, you know, his friend and compatriot was also someone who was fascinated with melodrama and cinema and shadows and mystery stories. So I don't know, just throwing that into the mix to see if there's anything there.
Yeah, I mean, both are brilliant points. You would maybe tell us more about what is his kind of historicism about cubism in the 50s, right? Like, yes, he has what's called, I think it's called the human comedy, and he's evoking all the Harlequins come back. There's all Matisse appears, this kind of caricature of Matisse, and Matisse will die in the 50s, of course. So there is this reckoning back to these tropes or these figures that he's inhabited. But I do wonder, what does he think about, let's say, the analytical moment in the 50s? And I think you could tell us more than I could. And for the nail thing, I think that's totally spot on. I mean, from what I understand, there's a split with Bloch. Again, I'm going to defer to your knowledge a little bit. Which is all to say, I think you're totally right pictorially. That's a kind of replacement of that unit. It's a melodramatic replacement of that unit. It's a humanization. It's an anthropomorphism. But to what extent he's trying to hearken back with any degree of intention, I would keep open, I think. But thank you.
I see one in the back. Oh, I'll come running. Throw it. Oh God, I'm a little nervous. We can do it though. Well, here, I got this far.
Thank you. There you go. Now, Picasso, in his early days as a painter and an artist, he drew from the past. Mm-hmm. He drew from the 19th century, from even before then, correct?
Yes.
Okay. So that was a moment of revolutionary change in everything. We're in another moment, would you say, now, of revolutionary change?
Our moment, you and I, today?
Yeah.
I mean, the safe answer is yes. But the question I would ask secondly is, tell me a period that hasn't felt like it's having revolutionary change.
I'm sorry.
I wanted to say that I think the answer to that question would be yes, but I do think about, like, is there a period that has not internalized its own sense of revolutionary change? What would be a period that doesn't have that kind of change, which is a kind of tricky answer to your question?
Well, I bring this up because you know, as someone who gives tours here,
yeah,
I'm always getting new people coming through. Very few of them have any idea what was happening in the 20th century or what is happening before then. You have to sort of start from the very, very beginning for them. And I'm just wondering, how would you do it? How would you introduce them to Picasso? How would you introduce them to the 20th century?
I love that question.
When, frankly, they don't give a damn.
I mean, there's a number of educators in the room who I'm sure have answers, but were I to teach it, I mean, I think this is a, I'll do like a kind of academic way to answer that, is I think Clark is right. I think the 19th century haunts a lot of Picasso, even up to World War II. And I'm actually convinced by the bourgeois interior has this kind of apparatus. That's a fancy way to say that. But a way to get people into Picasso now, one, you have to deal with what is the kind of attrition of his reputation, which is a bunch of different things than it used to be, let's say, 30 years ago. And I think you have to break through that. I will say very openly that I find Cubism quite amazing, and it's extremely hard to understand. It's extremely hard to write about, which is just not a barrier of entry, but I think that complexity makes it extremely fun. And there's few, again, I'll be a total put my cards on the table, there's few moments more exciting than figuring out how a synthetic Cubism collage works. And I think if you are really deliberate about that kind of work and you say, like, okay, this newspaper is kind of the violin right now, but it's also standing in for a background. I mean, to me, I used to teach Cubism, the good exercise was to have like two shapes, like two circles, units that are functionally identical, but how could they stand for different things? If I put like a dot in one circle, it means something totally different. If I put a kind of cross through that circle, it means something else. And so basically what you do is you try to teach the semiotic approach in an accessible way, I think is one way into that. Yeah, that's, they may not answer your question, but it's a personal one, I guess, or like a, sorry?
Well, actually, maybe I'll just ask while I've got this in my hand, just a sort of very quick follow-up question to that. Well, it's probably not a very quick one at all, but it just makes me think, sort of coming out of this very kind of evocative talk and thinking about this moment of extreme reflection on Pablo Picasso and his legacy that's happening, just about your own, like, your own motivations or stakes on bringing in the sentimental.
I had this scene that I put in the talk, which was Ernest, where I was in this problematic show, I was going to review it, and I was like, okay, this comedian is X, Y, Z to say. But this painting, it was so, again, melodramatic, and there was something so kind of confessional about it. And I was like, all the terms that we've been given in the show don't explain this work to me. And it was so kind of cinematic. So the sincerity of that piece is something, in that show, we got a very kind of rakish Picasso who cared about nobody except himself, who used and abused women. And this idea of, again, I put it in these terms, the sad Picasso. And then so what I wanted to do, and again, when I was doing a lot of that writing, I wanted to, if I could pull it off, was to discount neither people who love those shows, nor the kind of very correct critics who disliked it. Like, what if both constituencies were actually correct? And that show was funny, amazing, and showed what Picasso's deal was. What if we took both those audiences to be absolutely correct in their opinion? And then so it made me want to kind of take the seminalism really seriously. I think a lot of that is the work that I do. I mostly work on German Expressionism. We were talking about this earlier. And this is art that is trying to be emotional in extremely simple terms. It is trying to affect someone who someone looks at it. And I think as art historians, we're trained to deconstruct that address. It's an extremely direct address. But it's actually quite difficult to take that address on its own terms. Because the question, like, how does it make you feel, is both the most benign but also the most complex question when you look at art. And so it's one that I take quite seriously. And a part of that is also, I think, the book that I mentioned, the scholar named Jennifer Doyle, I just reread for this talk. And that's mostly a kind of queer theory feminist lineage, which is where you take bad feelings or sympathy or sentimentalism, melodrama, you take that seriously and see what happens.
Yeah. Thank you so much for that. I think we have time maybe for sort of one final question.
Make it good.
Thank you, Joseph. Wow, what a great talk. It's so fascinating because when I saw the Brooklyn show, that was the one piece that stood out to me above every single one. And I think they actually made the point in the audio commentary that this was, that there was a sort of aberration in Picasso's self-imaging in this painting. And they sort of presented him as a sad Picasso losing his lover. So I'm so glad that you tackled this work and this moment, a very specific, as you say, very specific diaristic moment that's date stamped, that, you know, we can, that we're being asked to look very locally in time. One of the things I'm really interested in your talk is the way that you are very local to Picasso in 1953. And you're also, not just historiographically, but thinking about the trajectory of Picasso's entire career from not just from Cubism, but you know, from the very beginnings. And I think, as Francesca said earlier, like thinking about, you know, 1905, thinking about the you know, Douglas Cooper's book on the theater, is everything about, in Picasso, is about theater. Interestingly, just as a side note, there is, I found a footnote that said there is an 1898 clipping of an essay called Shadow Mania.
Now we're talking.
Yep, that it was left in Picasso's library. So food for thought for you for thinking about tracing Shadow Mania from, I think that would be a great title for a book, from the very, very beginnings of Picasso's career. We'll talk about that later. But my question for you really is, in thinking about this notion of the shadow either as self, alter ego, as you beautifully say, the co-presence of presence and absence of, and as I think what you're doing with the shadow is really interesting, because you're bringing together the question of the self and the ego and the question of representation, which are the two core questions that drive Picasso's art, and you're showing that they are not incompatible. That's how I see your framework, you know, in, like, that we so often decouple those two paradigms, as you say, right? But the shadow is a really fascinating way of bringing those together. So my question for you is about how you see the shadow as a through line. Do you see the shadow as a through line in Picasso's work? But I guess more specifically, because you've dwelled quite a bit on Cubism and on the writing on Cubism, and even, of course, the really, really significant formal way that shadow essentially creates Cubism, right?
Yeah.
I mean, right? So the separation of light and shadow into planar relationships is what drives Picasso's Cubism. How do you see these works as post-Cubist, or like what is their relationship to the like legacy of Picasso's Cubism, if that's a question?
Yeah, no, that's the nail on the head. In part because I kept saying that, and I was like, what extent is this a Cubist painting? And that's an open question. Like, you know, what it can, like, yeah, the faceting, the angles, it almost reduces Cubism to a kind of, like, crazy perspective, which we know it's more than that. So I need to think more, which is a bearing ring. But I'm fascinated by the idea of post-Cubism. And so I was reading some work, I was reading the, like, Edward Said, for example, on late work, and this notion of the late work, like Cubism after the fact. Again, as part of the answer prior, I like bad objects, and the 50s is the bad object. This is Picasso washed out. This is Picasso out to sea. And if I was doing more research, I'd love to see if he's looking at any art in that period, like Nouveau Realisme. Like, is there any practice that is informing that? That's the opposite of what you asked for. And I'll show my hand. I'm very bad at pre-1907. I don't do a lot of work on symbolist Picasso, and I certainly have more to learn. And you're absolutely right. You're probably thinking of the same essay by Emily Braun, right, which is where shadows dictate the course. She does this extremely technical reading in the Cubism seminars, where it's the device of the shadow that lets her go from 7 to 8 to 10 to 12, and so in the years and so forth like that. But that said, the reason why I was funny, because I did research for this, I was reading all these genealogies of the shadow in Western art, and I found them so kind of boring. Like, or I don't know, like, it was just, like, the shadow is everything and nothing, and I want, you know, it was the alter ego, it was absence and presence, and I wanted to keep it local for that reason. And what I think is actually nice is this is not the Freudian bad shadow, right? This is not the kind of evil shadow that comes and kind of, actually, that goes back to the shadow mania, that's like Fantomas, that is the kind of mass culture shadow of 1900 that I don't see playing here. And so that's one answer. So I was not inclined to go into genealogies of the shadow. I mean, I would like to track, like, I think I kind of had a through line, but what do we do with the moments of rupture in the shadow? Like the non-Cubist, like, sure, the neoclassical, if you want to call it that, like, what does the shadow do there? It'll also be the next step, too.
Cubism is the precedent for surrealism because it negates
the binary of light and shadow.
You mean pictorially or formally?
Pictorially.
Okay.
Pictorially.
Yeah.
And so I think this is an interesting work to kind of think about in that, in both the post-cubist and like post-surrealist.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good connection.
All right, so I think this is clearly a conversation that is just beginning, not ending. But I want to thank everyone. I want to thank Joseph so much for his wonderful lecture. And I also want to give a huge thank you to the audience for your incredibly rich questions and discussion, which really added so much to it, for me at least. So thank you all
so
much.
Thank you, folks.
And thank you also everyone online.
The talk's only as good as its Q&A, so thank you.
So thank you.